Welcome back. They are the defenders of our territorial waters. The Philippine Navy celebrates this year its 115th anniversary. This year's theme is Navy, an adventure of honorable service to our maritime nation. To mark this milestone, the elite units of the Navy will be holding capability demonstrations on disaster and medical response. No less than President Aquino will be their guest of honor.
And not only that, the Navy will also be turning over a multi-purpose covered court to a barangay in Catiil, Davao Oriental for the locals who bore the brunt of Typhoon Pamalo late last year. And looking ahead, the BRP Ramon Alcaraz, the second of several former U.S. Coast Guard Hamilton class cutters, is set to arrive in August. And we have a lot to talk about. Joining us in the studio now is Vice Admiral Jose Luis Alano to tell us all about that. Good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon, Caroline, and good afternoon, Stanley. Yes, it's good to be here. The Navy indeed will be celebrating its 115th founding anniversary. And the Navy, as part of the Armed Forces of the Philippines, is one of the major services that does the security of our territories and the defenders of our sovereignty, as well as the protectors of our people.
Backtracking a bit, sir, please tell us about that 150-year-long service of
the Philippine Navy. Certainly so much to celebrate.
Yes. The Philippine Navy traces its roots back to the time of the Magdalo, during the time of Aguinaldo, wherein immediately after the revolution, there was a need for a mosquito fleet, and no less than Pascua de Ledesma headed the first Navy, and that formed part of that requirement. Because as you see it, the Philippines is an archipelago.
Exactly.
And because of that, the need for a Navy to secure its territory, which is actually more water than land. If you look at our resources, our areas of territory, we are actually a body of water studded in, with islands. And our water domain that we have to secure and protect is actually three times that of land.
How challenging is that as a task for the Philippine Navy?
Quite challenging in the sense that because of the specific type of environment, which is quite different. As you do this, usually when we have this type of things to perform our specific roles and tasks, we use it's really what you can. There are three aspects that has to be taken into consideration for any organization, and first foremost is the mission. Our mission is about defense and security primarily, as well as safety and sanitation and service. Aside from that, we have also to look at the environment in which we have to address it. Now, the AAP is comprised of three environment forces. One is the air, the land, and the maritime. The Navy takes charge of the maritime. And because of its peculiarity in terms of maritime, wherein it's just open sea and subjective to the conditions of the weather. And in doing so, you need certain capabilities in order to stay out there and able to control the situation. And the Navy is organized to provide such a capability wherein we have to operate on the surface of the water, above it, and below it. And not only that, from it, wherein we need to influence as well the situation on land. That's why the Navy is actually a fleet marine team.
But the question is, and always the question coming in, how equipped are we?
Just let me say, the Navy, more so under this current administration, is slowly but surely developing its capabilities. And we are getting there to what we intend to be, wherein we have a vision as part of our sail plan 2020.
How close
to be
are we
strong,
to that vision?
Incredible. Just let me say that we are getting there. And there are a lot of activities that are now projecting us to be in that level. First and foremost, what should be developed is our people, because this is our pride always and the most important resource of any organization. And as we have that, they must be able to be technically qualified, and with it now the necessary capabilities. Based on the latest developments, wherein we have now Republic Act 10349, which allows now the modernization of the armed forces of the Philippines, wherein this administration under the Commander-in-Chief, has committed $75 billion to increase the capability of the armed forces of the Philippines, wherein the Navy now is a major beneficiary of this. Mm-hmm. We're looking forward now with different capabilities. Just lately, we had the first cutter, Gregorio del Pilar, which boosted our capability of securing our maritime environment. We look for the second one, BRP Alcaraz, or PF-16, which we hope to be here in August, the first week of August. And aside from that, just lately, there was the signing of a contract for the delivery of naval helicopters that will boost as well as the capability of the Navy. The last year, we were able to get multipurpose attack crafts, which are now used for special operations, particularly by our special operations group.
Aren't your priorities changing, considering that the landscape is also changing? We have issues like the external forces, the disputes in the West Philippine Sea. We have Taiwan of late. Perhaps
not to mention
Saba
even
is also an issue.
Not to mention the stranding of some vessels in the Tubatha
Reef.
Yes, to look at the environment, indeed the landscape as far as the security situation is improving. Actually developing, wherein now we see in the past, we had always internal problems as the major focus of our problem. But as we have been moving forward, particularly with our IPSP campaign plan, Bayanihan, our peace campaign plan, we see a lot of progress in development. And we're projecting by 2016, the situation will be now wherein the internal security will be one that is manageable, and we'll be now looking at for the external concerns of our nation. Having said that, because of the developing security, what we're seeing also is a positive growth now of our nation. We are now in the best times as far as our economic development is concerned. No less than the international financial communities have been saying that we are now investment grade. And even look at our stock market. It's now more than 70. We have break the 7,400 mark as far as the index are concerned. And this is because you have a stable country. Mm-hmm. There is peace and order that is developing. And because of that, we did as well. We are now able to look at other concerns, where now the armed forces of the Philippines, our country, can be one that is truly responsible and can contribute to regional stability mm-hmm. in the area.
Sir, it's easy also to be optimistic. I mean, looking ahead, you're saying 2016 definitely is ideally internal security should have been managed, and you're looking outward. But of course, of late, as Stanley also mentioned, there are immediate realities. So, how is the Navy addressing these concerns?
Having said that, the Navy continues to be equipped with its best resource, which are its people.
And how many are we talking about?
The Philippine Navy is comprised, a Fleet Marine Team is comprised about 23,000 people strong, highly dedicated, and have committed to themselves to serve and protect this country. Having said that, despite the different situations that are out there, the Navy has been in the forefront. From the security of the Western Philippine Seas to our borders. Just this last election, the Philippine Navy was at the forefront in ensuring that the elections will be, as part of the armed forces of the Philippines, that the elections will be conducted safely, that is secured and free. And with the situations that have been developing, the Navy was able to properly implement this with its different units that are scattered throughout the country, together with our different marine forces that were projected, particularly in southern and western Philippines. Mm-hmm. And they have been able to help and assist in providing this necessary security in the country.
This current country is spending a lot in terms of defense, the defense budget. Now, how much of that are you getting? Is the Navy getting prioritized in terms of allocating defense resources?
Just let me say that the budget is there, that continues. The budget will always depend. When you talk really of budget, everybody will say their budget is always lacking. Mm-hmm. But just let me say that despite whatever budget is being there about is being provided for us, we will continue to perform our duties based on the budget.
And are the resources realistic in terms of the added challenges that the Navy is facing? I'm pretty sure AFP, the Army, is getting the lion's share of that.
Now, just let me say that this is continuously being discussed. There is a process in which this is being done, wherein we prepare our budget as part of the system, and this is elevated through the different activities and the budgeting process. What is being done? The Navy is one of the program managers under the Department of Defense, and we submit our requirements based on the mission tasks that will be allocated to us. And based on that mission task, we tell the higher leadership that this will be the necessary requirements that will allow us to perform our jobs. And with it, a decision is being made whether or not these tasks that are to be allocated will be performed. Mm-hmm. But despite that, based on what you see now, based on the statistics and the records that can show that the Navy and the Armed Forces of the Philippines has been able to perform its mandate. Mm-hmm. Just like recently on Typhoon Pablo. Again, your Armed Forces of the Philippines, despite also being affected by the typhoon that hit Southern Mindanao, was immediately there, providing the necessary service that would protects our people. Now, when we were there just this last December and made an assessment, the problems were, alam mo yung, you know, the Filipino has this wonderful value culture, bayanihan. We tend to help each other during our times of need. And that's something so wonderful. And when you see that out there, when, for example, what happened to Davao Oriental or the North and portions of Mindanao, immediately, there was immediate response throughout all sectors of society helped and ensured that they would be able to provide the necessary assistance. But as we were looking at it, the devastation was so immense that they need as well as structures. And
this is the reason you're going back.
Yeah, that's why. We saw that there was a requirement to establish something more permanent than shelter hubs or shelter bags or tents to do that. So we made designs to create a multi-purpose shelter, one that is more durable and can be used also aside from just an evacuation center in terms of the disaster, but also for other purposes. That's why it's called a multi-purpose. And when we made the design, we asked other agencies or organizations if they would like to help. And there was a pouring out of support for this. And early this May, on May 6, we just inaugurated the first shelter. And the people there were so happy for having that structure.
We're looking at the pictures of that shelter.
Yes.
This is...
Preparations pa lang, no?
This was taken when it was just being built.
It was being built.
Is it completed?
Yes, it's now completed. This started in... The ground vacate started last February 4, and we just inaugurated it... on May 6th. This is now completed. We did one for Katiil. Together with other stakeholders like the Church of Christ of Latter-day Saints, Harbor Center, and a lot of other support, very, very kind-hearted people out there. We're building shelters as well as for Baganga and Boston that were in most of their structures were really devastated. Mm-hmm.
Tell us about the Navy's involvement in rescue and relief operations. It could be a challenge for a lot of areas in the Philippines, particularly the eastern seaboard, very unreachable. When disaster strikes, the Navy, parang kayo yung first responders in terms
first
of bringing
of
relief
defense.
And rescue
yes.
in these areas.
Actually, based on, it's particularly on the eastern side, that's quite correct because
quite
of
vulnerable.
It's very vulnerable. And then aside from that, it's the accessibility is usually through,
and
through the sea.
I understand the sea conditions are very hostile. And
No, it also depends. Yeah. The sea is always, we call it, the term we say is weather. So there are times where it is quite calm, but at the times as well it is rough. So you just have to bear it or what we call it as part as leadership is concerned, when the weather is bad, we turn to take shelter. But when for an optimist, they say the weather will change for the better. Mm-hmm. But for us, particularly in the Navy, as leaders, we have to adjust our sails and make sure that we're able to brand whatever is out there.
And how exactly are you adjusting those sails when it comes to disaster response?
As far as disaster response is concerned, with all the support that we are getting, no less from our commander-in-chief that's always on top of the situation, flowing down the line to the Department of National Defense as well as our chief of staff. We've been able to increase our capabilities for disaster response. And actually, we have just taken hold of some additional funds for quick response, wherein we're now developing certain capabilities for immediate disasters, like providing immediately capabilities for search and rescue and response equipments for both floods and landslides and collapse of infrastructure, as well as ability to be able to sustain it. One of the major issues that usually you see is providing the medical assistance and hospitals that are there. Now we have designed a takeaway kit, like a mobile hospital placed inside a container van, where you can just connect a generator to it and some water, and will provide the necessary enough facilities to immediately respond to such a requirement.
So certainly the capability is something that the Navy is building up on. But as far as also capability goes, outside of the issue of disasters, when it comes to defining the territory, there have been previous interviews where they've brought up the issue of maps and technical gadgets that actually help determine which part of the territory is ours and are we overreaching it. This came up in the issue of the Tubatahar, if I understand. Is the Navy on the same page when it comes to these different gadgets as other countries? They were saying we were using a different equipment altogether.
Now, as far as our government is concerned, certain agencies are responsible, for example, for mapping areas, and that doesn't really fall under the Navy's major role is on security and defense. There are other organizations like NAMRIA, which is actually
for mapping.
For mapping this. But talking about Tubata, one thing I can say for sure is that it is within our archipelagic waters. So there's no doubt about that. But for the exact precise location for that, we've been patrolling that area already for quite a long time. And based on the charts and maps that, when you talk about nautical, we call maps charts. Mm-hmm. Charts. So as far as the charts that we've been using, it has been quite accurate, and we seldom have any problems with it. But talking about it, I think the way it has been addressed, this has been addressed properly in terms of a multi-agency has addressed the issues that have been relating to.
Talking of defense, we have a current situation in the Philippines, Batanes-Taiwan border. We've seen a show of force from Taiwan a couple of days ago. Are we ready, not to go to war, but are we ready to defend our territories when such is required?
Let me say this. As far as the armed forces of the Philippines is concerned, we're in the Philippine Navy. We are there. We have committed ourselves for the defense and security of our country and our nation. But looking at the incident that just happened lately, this is just one thing I would say, that as far as how the incident happened, this is well within our exclusive economic zone. Now, we just hope that this unfortunate incident
can be resolved diplomatically.
Looking at the history with it, we have always been very good neighbors, and the Philippines has always maintained a policy that war has never been used as a national policy, and that we have always been following the rule of law, and we would rather have things be addressed in a due process using the proper structures
and
of international the national channels to address such.
But is there additional deployment in the Batanes area in light of this?
Just let me say that the Navy continues to perform its role in ensuring that we will be able to.
So it's all in a day's work there?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. And as far as assisting perhaps investigations go, does the Navy have any hand in it?
Now, there has been already an agency that has been directed to ensure that the conduct of the investigation will be transparent and done properly. And I understand this is the National Bureau of Investigation is conducting the investigation. Mm-hmm.
But then again, we are also, of course, discussing the Philippine Navy and its 115th anniversary, the theme being Navy, an adventure of honorable service to our maritime nation. What is in store as far as activities go for the celebration?
Actually, we've been having several activities that has been addressed towards that. But this is not really part, we just say it's part of our peer anniversary activities. But we have already conducted one, was a Football for Peace activity, mm-hmm. which was sponsored by no less by our Philippine Marine Corps. And this has actually been noted internationally because of what we did was to adapt the children or the youth from the different affected areas, like from Southern Mindanao and Palawan, and they organized them into football teams and brought them all over here in Manila, and they had a friendly games with the youth here coming from different schools and organizations like the dependents of members of the armed forces, but even from schools like from La Salle, Ateneo, and some of the Don Bosco and other schools there. And there was this wonderful exchange, and you know, when it comes to the youth, there is just this free exchange of things, and one that you see a very interactive socialization.
And goodwill.
That's right, mm-hmm. that's right.
But then, of course, beyond that, there is a huge task ahead of the Navy, and this celebration will definitely be a highlight to the 115 years it served. When is this happening? And
the Navy will be celebrating its Navy Day on May 21st with no less than the Commander-in-Chief, President Aquino, attending. It will be something that particularly will be highlighting the people, more importantly, who have proven themselves and contributed to the various accomplishments of the Navy, particularly one of securing our territory and defending our people. But also, it will be something that we would like to also highlight the different activities wherein your Navy now is going, as we are constantly trying to do better and improve our different capabilities. This will be some of the highlights as part of our two basic strategic directions. First, we have the Navy Sail Plan, which is part of our capacity and capability development, where we would like to increase our capabilities to perform our jobs. And that is through our people, our organization, our doctrines on how we do things, as well as the necessary equipment that will be needed to do that. And with it also, this is aligned to what we should be doing, which is our defense strategy. And in our defense strategy, we are looking at how we would be able to really to know what is happening and provide the necessary response with cooperation at different levels, from within the organization of the armed forces to within nationally, but also globally as part of the region.
And on that note, we do thank you for your time. Vice Admiral Jose Luis Alano, Flag Officer in Command of the Philippines.
Congratulations.
Congratulations. And more power to the next 100 years.
Thank you.
Thank you.
We'll take a quick break. When we return, conflict-torn Syria tries to safeguard its national treasure.
And China finds a solution for elderly care in rural towns. Stay tuned. You're watching Dateline Philippines Weekend.